The hits.
Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. This program is aimed at English learners. So we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English.
On today's program, Dan Friedel tells us about a new study on dog personalities. John Russell presents a new episode of Everyday Grammar. We close with the next part of our U.S. history series, The Making of a Nation. But first, a new housing center for the Vatican's Swiss Guard Force will reportedly accommodate both male and female members. The purpose of the force is to guard the residence of Pope Francis, as well as all official entrances to Vatican City in Rome, Italy. Currently, only males are permitted to serve in the Swiss Guard. A Swiss organization is raising money to build the new housing center, also called a barracks. The organization signed an agreement with the Vatican's Secretary of State on May 4th. An official with the foundation of the Pontifical Swiss Guard told Reuters, "The agreement calls for the new barracks to have single rooms with private bathrooms. The barracks where the Swiss Guard members now live is a shared space." The official, Ricardo Boscardin, said there were two reasons the new barracks will have the ability to separate guard members. One is because COVID hit when the project started, and the second is the possibility of integrating women into the guard, he said. When asked about the possibility of women joining the force, Boscardin said, "This decision is not ours, but exclusively that of the Vatican and the Pope." The rule requiring guard members to be male goes back to the year 1506, when the force was created. Members must also be Catholic, unmarried, and have Swiss citizenship. The 85-year-old Pope Francis has already named women to several high positions in the Vatican administration. In March, he introduced a new constitution that permits any baptized Catholic, including women, to head most Vatican departments. The foundation of the Pontifical Swiss Guard is seeking to raise about $46 million to replace the current barracks, Boscardin told Reuters. He said work was expected to begin in January of 2026. That date was chosen so members would not be displaced during the 2025 Holy Year, when millions of visitors are expected to travel to the Vatican. Boscardin said the site of the current barracks will be kept or rebuilt exactly as it is now. He noted that the new barracks will look a lot like the existing one on the outside. But he said building a new, environmentally friendly barracks will cost much less than repairing the existing one.
A new study has found that all dogs have different personalities, even dogs of the same breed. Eleanor Carlson studies genetics at the University of Massachusetts. She co-wrote a report about the study, which appeared recently in the publication Science. Carlson said, "Every dog really is an individual." Carlson noted there is a huge amount of variation, even between dogs that look the same. At a New York dog park, dog owners told the Associated Press about the different characteristics of their pets. Elizabeth Kelly owns an English Springer Spaniel. She called her dog friendly, but also kind of the queen bee. In other words, her dog likes to act like she is in charge of other dogs. Suli Ortiz owns a yellow Labrador. She described her dog as calm, lazy, and shy. Rachel Kim has a dog that is a mix of several breeds. She described the animal as super independent and loving. Dogs first became friendly to humans around 14,000 years ago. But the idea of dog breeds is much more recent. Around 160 years ago, humans began to breed dogs to have certain physical qualities, such as fur texture and color and ear shape. Carlson said her aim was to learn how much a dog's breed affects their behavior. The answer? Breed does not decide an individual dog's personality. Carlson's team gathered information from 18,000 dog owners and studied the genetic code of over 2,000 dogs. The researchers found that some qualities are based on genetics. However, there is no guarantee that two dogs of the same breed will behave in the same way. For example, they found golden retrievers that do not retrieve. To retrieve is to get and bring something back from a place. Some breeds, such as huskies and beagles, may be more likely to howl or make a long, loud barking sound. But many of these dogs do not howl, as owner observations showed. In addition, the researchers were not able to link aggression to a certain breed. Jeff Kidd studies genetics at the University of Michigan. He was not involved in the dog project. He said, "The connection between dog breed and behavior is much lower than most expected." Adam Boyko studies genetics at Cornell University. He also was not involved in the dog research. He noted that Carlson and her team organized the most data ever about dogs. I'm Dan Friedel.
Today's Everyday Grammar, we will explore a common issue in grammar classes, dangling participles. These structures can reduce clarity in communication. You will learn about how to identify and correct dangling participles. Let's start with a few important terms and ideas. Imagine you walk into a small shop that sells sodas or sweet drinks. You see it has Coke, Pepsi, Sprite, among others. The drinks contain many of the same things: carbonated water, sugar, or high fructose corn syrup, but they also have different flavors and colors. Participles are in some ways like soda. But instead of carbonated water or sugar, participles have the verb as their raw ingredient. Because they come from verbs, participles are known as verbals. Much like our sodas, participles come in a few different flavors, present and past. The present participle is the verb with an ing ending. The past has a few special flavors of its own, such as the ed or en ending, among others. Participles are verbals, but they often act as adjectives. In other words, they give extra information about nouns or pronouns. Consider this example.
The barking dog woke up the whole neighborhood.
Here, the participle barking acts like an adjective that describes the noun dog. Sometimes participles come in phrases, groups of words that act together in a sentence. One common way participial phrases appear is as an introduction to a sentence. Consider this example.
Barking loudly, the dog woke up the whole neighborhood.
In this case, the participial phrase is barking loudly. The subject of the participial phrase is also the subject of the sentence, the noun dog. But what happens when the subject of the participle and the subject of the sentence are different? Our earlier example would be something like this.
Barking loudly, the whole neighborhood woke up.
This example is known as a dangling participle. The subject of the participle, barking loudly, is missing. The subject of this sentence is the whole neighborhood. But it is not the whole neighborhood that is barking. Such a situation would be truly bizarre. So, a dangling participle is a kind of verb that does not have a stated subject. The dangling participle has lost its point of connection with the sentence. Our dangling participle is in some ways like a rock climber. Imagine a rock climber is going up a steep cliff. The rock climber needs points of connection, hands and feet, with the rock. If the rock climber loses these points of connection, he or she falls and hangs or dangles in space on a safety rope. Such a situation is uncomfortable for the climber and for people watching. The same is true for a dangling participle. It has lost its points of connection with the sentence and is hanging in space. The reader or listener might not know what is being communicated. But our rock climbing comparison can also present an answer. To succeed in the climb, the rock climber must stay close to the rock and keep points of connection. Participial phrases and other structures that act like adjectives are generally clearest when they stay close to the noun they are describing. The greater the distance between the participial phrase and the noun, the greater the chance it will become a dangling participle. Common sources of dangling participles include sentences with their or it in the subject position, as well as sentences that use the passive voice. For example,
having moved the bookshelves and bed, there was no room for the desk.
In such a case, one way to clarify the point is to expand the participial phrase into a full clause. The updated sentence could be something like this.
After we moved the bookshelves and bed, there was no room for the desk.
In today's report, you learned about a few images that connect with participles, participial phrases, and dangling participles. A soda shop, a barking dog, and a rock climber. While all of these comparisons have their limitations, they can help you imagine situations and connect grammar to life. Such connections are important for helping you remember information. But keep in mind, participles and participial phrases are a large subject. Today's report offered a few thoughts. There is much more that could be said. We will explore more details about participles and participial phrases in future reports. I'm John Russell.
Welcome to The Making of a Nation, American History in VOA Special English. I'm Steve Ember. For most of the 1990s, the nation was at peace. The Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, bringing an end to years of costly military competition. During the 90s, the American economy recovered from a recession and grew strong. Inflation and unemployment were low. There were new developments in medicine and technology. The Internet began to evolve from a defense project, mainly linking researchers, into a new way for the world to communicate. America grew by almost 33 million people during the 1990s, the largest increase of any decade in its history. By the end of the 90s, more than 280 million people were living in the United States. During the decade of the 90s, there was a large increase in immigration from Latin America, the Caribbean, and Asia. For the first time in 70 years, one in 10 Americans was born in another country. At the same time, the population was getting older. That added to the nation's health care costs. America's new president, Bill Clinton, promised to reform the health care system. But in the end, like other presidents before him, Clinton failed to win support for that idea in Congress. Divorce rates in the United States had begun to grow sharply in the 1990s. By then, those rates were starting to drop. But there were millions of children living with only one parent or with their grandparents. Single-parent families are more likely to be poor. In 1980, single-parent households represented about 20% of all households in the United States with children. By 1990, that number had reached 24% and was continuing to rise. In 1991, a black man named Rodney King led police in Los Angeles on a high-speed chase. After the chase, officers tried to arrest him. A man living nearby videotaped police officers striking King repeatedly with their sticks and kicking him on the ground. The officers later said King had resisted even after they shocked him with an electric stun gun. The man took the 81-second video to a local television station. Soon, people all over the country were watching it. The beating led to criminal charges against four white police officers. The trial was moved out of Los Angeles. Their lawyers argued that the officers might not receive a fair trial there. On April 29, 1992, a mostly white jury in a community north of the city returned its findings. The jury found the officers not guilty of assaulting Rodney King. Anger at the jury's verdict soon led to rioting that began in the largely poor black neighborhoods of South Central Los Angeles.
Don't go near this area, South Central Los Angeles at Florence and Normandy, because there is still no police presence there, and a lot of people trying to get through that intersection have been assaulted with rocks and bottles and sticks.
More than 50 people died in days of violence before police and troops brought the unrest under control. Many more were injured, and hundreds of buildings were destroyed by fire. It was some of the worst rioting in American history and received worldwide attention. The following year, a federal jury found two of the officers who had beaten Rodney King guilty of violating his civil rights. They were sent to prison. Another case in Los Angeles that received international attention also involved a racial element. O.J. Simpson, a black former football star and motion picture actor, was charged with murdering his white former wife and a male friend of hers. They were stabbed to death in 1994. Many legal experts believed the case against Simpson was strong. So did many more whites than blacks in public opinion surveys. A mostly black jury found Simpson not guilty. But later, in a civil case brought by the victim's families, a mostly white jury found him responsible for the killings and ordered him to pay damages. In 1990, researchers launched the Human Genome Project. This was a government-supported effort to identify and map all of the genes in the body. The Human Genome Project raised hopes for new medical treatments and cures for diseases. The project lasted 13 years until 2003. In 2000, President Clinton announced the completion of a working draft of the genome.
It will revolutionize the diagnosis, prevention, and treatment of most, if not all, human diseases.
During the 1990s, personal computers became more and more a part of everyday life. And more people were going online over a network linking computers around the world. The internet would grow into an easy way to send email, find information, and buy products over the World Wide Web. In music, many Americans in the early 90s were listening to a new sound from the Pacific Northwest. It became known as grunge rock. The capital for grunge bands was Seattle in Washington State. One of the best-known bands was Nirvana. Their 1991 album, Nevermind, contains some of their most successful songs, including Smells Like Teen Spirit. Kurt Cobain helped define the grunge sound. He was Nirvana's lead singer, guitar player, and songwriter. But in April 1994, that voice was silenced. Officials said he killed himself with a shotgun. Kurt Cobain was 27 years old, the husband of singer Courtney Love, and one of the most influential musicians of his day. On television, millions of people watched shows like ER, a drama series about a busy hospital emergency room. Many fans tuned in to watch George Clooney play a young doctor on the show.
What's going on?
Mr. Abbott asked us to try to resuscitate his son.
Still flatline, atrophy and tube epi.
He shouldn't have made it through the night. the hell are you?
I'm Dr. Ross, but look, he was in my care.
ER first went on the air in 1994 and lasted 15 years. Law and Order was a crime drama, but it took a different path, involving the interactions of police, lawyers, and judges. The popularity of the series, set in New York, led to several related Law and Order spin-off series. For laughs, millions of people watched shows like Seinfeld and Friends. The Friends were Ross, Rachel, Monica, Phoebe, Joey, and Chandler, six young New Yorkers. Seinfeld was also set in, you guessed it, New York. It starred comedian Jerry Seinfeld playing himself. The series was hugely popular and won many awards. TV Guide magazine put it at the top of its 2002 list of the 50 greatest shows of all time.